Joins to hold. And she says, let it be done. You've planned and you've prepared, you've done well. Relax, enjoy yourself, and let it be done.
The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And with your spirit.
Michael Douglas Marsh, Mckenzie Lynn Bluder. The church welcomes you, shares your joy, and warmly welcomes you together with your families and friends as today, in the presence of God our Father, you establish between yourselves a lifelong partnership. May the Lord hear you on this your joyful day. May he send you help from heaven and protect you. May he grant you your heart's desires and fulfill every one of your prayers. Let us pray. Be attentive to our prayers, O Lord, and in your kindness, pour out your grace on these your servants, Doug and Mckenzie, that coming together before your altar, they may be confirmed in love for you and for one another. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us now listen with Doug and Mckenzie to the words that God speaks to us today. You may be seated.
Blessed are those who fear the Lord.
Blessed are those who fear the Lord.
By the labor of your hands you shall eat. You will be blessed and prosper. Your wife, like a fruitful vine in the heart of your house. Your children, like shoots of the olive around your table. Indeed, thus shall be blessed the man who fears the Lord. May the Lord bless you from Zion all the days of your life. May you see your children's children.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, strive eagerly for the greatest spiritual gifts. But I shall show you a still more excellent way. If I speak in human and angelic tongues, but do not have love, I am a resounding gong or a clashing cymbal. And if I have the gift of prophecy and comprehend all mysteries and all knowledge, if I have all faith so as to move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away everything I own, and if I hand my body over so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind. It is not jealous, it is not pompous. It is not inflated, it is not rude. It does not seek its own interest. It is not quick-tempered, it does not brood over injury. It does not rejoice over wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Mother said to him, "They have no more wine." "Woman, why do you involve me?" Jesus replied. "My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby stood six stone water jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washings, each holding more than 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet." They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, "Everyone brings out the choice wines first, and then the cheaper wine after the guest had had too much to drink. But you have saved the best till now." What Jesus did here in Cana at Galilee was the first of the signs through which he revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
You may be seated. Doug, I don't know whether you are aware, but I was blessed with marrying a brutal woman, too. If you want any answers how to get it done, don't ask me, because I'm still earning. And that's a good thing, because sacramental love, the kind of pure, true love that pours from God's heart into yours, it doesn't consume people. It doesn't stunt their growth. In fact, it doesn't even stay in neutral. It always generates. It produces more. And this is why there's always going to be more of each other to know, more of each other to discover, more of each other to love, because love always grows the lover and the loved. There's a beautiful scene in the Gospel of Matthew in which Jesus invites Peter, James, and John to walk up the mountain with him. Now, they had been with him for 3 years. They've seen him. They've witnessed his healings. They've heard all of his teachings. They knew Jesus, or thought they did. But on that mountaintop, something happened. The skies cracked open, and Jesus was lifted up into the clouds, glowing in white. In front of their eyes, Jesus became the Imago Dei, the image of God. Peter was so overwhelmed, they were knocked to their knees. He tries desperately to come up with some kind of words that can capture the beauty and the significance about what he had experienced. But all he had to say was 7 simple words: "It is good that we are here." This is called the transfiguration of Jesus, in which he is revealed to be more than once thought. My friends Doug and Mckenzie have accepted the invitation of God to walk up the mountain with him, to come to this altar where their lives will be changed. Here's the deal. You could have had your wedding anywhere, because a wedding is about certification, but the sacrament of holy matrimony is about transformation, a change in who you are and who you will be. This is your transfiguration, when you will be raised up by the love of God and by the love of one another, by the love that God has poured into your hearts. It is at this altar that you will become the Imago Dei, the very image of God's love for one another, for your family, for all of us here to see. From this altar, you will become one. From this altar, you will stay one. And so to you, to your parents and grandparents, to all your friends and family, I say to all of you, it is good that we are here. You know, in each wedding marriage ceremony that I serve, I'm always intrigued by the action and the meaning of what occurs along the way in the aisle and the processional. There's a shared excitement, isn't there, of what is to come. As we look as the grandparents and the parents are seated, we watch as the bridesmaids enter to meet the groomsmen. We want to see the colors and the hairdos and see whether we can match up, determine who is who. And then, of course, the opening chords strike. Bodies rise and heads turn and eyes are fixed on the beautiful bride-to-be, escorted by her father. We watch that wonderful scene as the hand of a daughter is given over to become the hand of a wife. We've seen it all before. Many of us have experienced it. It's a traditional rite of passage, beautiful and emotionally charged, but it is so much more than that. You see, we're all going to be watching the same things, but we're not going to be seeing them in the same way. Some of us will be watching in the present as a beautiful young woman walks the aisle to greet a handsome bride, a groom-to-be, husband-to-be. But Mckenzie, as she walks, Doug, as he waits, they're in the present, but when their eyes lock, they see much more than the present. They see the promise of a beautiful future together for the parents, their grandparents, for all of those who helped raise you. They see beyond the present and the future. They see into the past as well. For your mothers, the eyes of their hearts still see the infant that they once held to their breasts, and they still feel your breath upon their cheeks as they held you. For the father, for Buck, as he walks down a woman to be married, he also walks with the remembrances that once he held a child and carried her down this same aisle to be baptized. This procession is not just an empty tradition or a way to get from point A to point B. It is a bite-sized sample of the very rhythm of life. As God weaves together the past and the present and the future into a beautiful tapestry of the human life, as he brings together the young and the old and hints at the possibility of new life not yet on earth, all the while we remember those who brought our lives here who are no longer on earth. The procession is also a visible narrative of how we live a sacramental life. When Mckenzie came down this aisle, she did not wander around, weaving in and out the aisles, high-fiving cousins, hugging college roommates, stopping for photo ops. Instead, she moved in a specific direction. She moved with a purpose. She moved to this altar, to that someone who can and will fulfill her life. And Doug, the bridegroom, you know, in casual eyes we look and not much going on there. It almost looks like he's an idle bystander just waiting and hoping that the show can get on the road. But my friends, there's so much more than that. Because what God demonstrates is the great Christian value of patience and trust. And the blessed assurance that if you wait patiently and are open to receive, God will bring you who and what you need to fulfill your own life. This, my friends, is the way of living the sacramental life. It is the intentional movement to God and the patient waiting in trust that he will provide for you. Mckenzie, you walked down these aisles many times. On many significant events in your life, you were carried as an infant, sometimes pushed and pulled by your parents as a child. There were times you walked on your own to receive communion, to become confirmed in the faith. But today, your parents did not bring you to this altar, nor did you walk alone. Listen, and this is important. You, Doug, and you, Mckenzie, locked arms, and you walked together the last few steps of your independent, single, individual lives to this altar. You came together here to become joined as one. And at this altar, you will become one. And at this altar, you will stay as one. You know, every bit of good news and good medicine always carries some warning labels to it. And it's true in this case as well. For the sacramental gifts that you will receive in this sacrament of holy matrimony will provide what you need, but it will not vaccinate you. It's not going to immunize you against hardships and heartache, injury and disease, sickness, mental ailments, natural disasters, and economic troubles are always going to be on the horizon. It's difficult to stay on the mountaintop, and you have to go out there into the messiness of life. And sometimes, even with the best of our plans and the greatest of our prayers, we still get bruised and battered. Our hopes and dreams begin to evaporate. There will be times that you will feel like the couple at Cana and their wedding that we heard in the gospel. I know this is going to be hard to believe as long as your Uncle Black and Aunt Karen are around. But there will be times that you will run out of wine. You'll run low on the wine of patience and gentleness with one another and with yourselves. You'll feel the wine of energy draining from yourselves at times. Maybe the wine of trust and certainty in God's goodness and His plan for you will seem to run dry as your struggles and challenges begin to flood in. But remember the pattern of today. Walk together to this altar. Wait with patience and trust, and your cups will be filled by the living water of the wines of God's graces. And remind yourselves in times of discomfort that from this altar you became one, and by God, from this altar you're going to stay one. And then maybe one day, it could be an ordinary, normal day, or maybe a special occasion, maybe an anniversary, maybe at times you are so blessed when you are carrying your own infant toward this altar, or maybe later, when you, as your own parents and grandparents, as you sit, watching your children or your children's children receive the same sacrament, you can reach over and grab the other's hands to remind them and to remind yourself, it is good that we are here together. Will everyone rise as the witness come forward? I want to ask you for your consent now. Here are the three questions. Mm-hmm. And the first one is, I have. Okay.
Sure.
Michael Douglas and Mckenzie, have you come here to enter into marriage without coercion, freely and wholeheartedly?
I have.
Are you prepared as you follow the path of marriage to love and honor each other for as long as you both shall live?
I am.
I am again. Are you prepared to accept children lovingly from God and to bring them up according to the law of Christ and of His church?
I am.
Witnesses get returned. From the vows. Okay? Right. So I'm going to say a few words and ask you to turn to each other and hold your right hands. Since it is your intention to enter the covenant of holy matrimony, join your right hands and declare your consent before God and of His church.
I, Michael Douglas, take you, Mckenzie, to be my wife. I promise to love you, be faithful to you in good times and bad, in sickness and in health, and to love and honor you all the days of my life.
I, Mckenzie, take you, Michael Douglas, to be my husband. I promise to be faithful to you in good times and in bad, in sickness and in health, to love and honor you all the days of my life.
May the Lord in his kindness strengthen the consent you have declared before the church and graciously bring to fulfillment his blessing within you. What God joins together, let no one put asunder. And so I ask all of you who have served as witnesses to respond to me, to my statement, thanks be to God. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now we're going to have the blessing of the rings. You can bring up with the rings. Oh boy. You can lay down. You can lay down. Extend the rings to me for the blessing of the holy water. May the Lord bless these rings which you will give to each other as a sign of love and fidelity. Mckenzie, receive this ring.
Mckenzie, receive this ring.
As a sign of my love and fidelity.
As a sign of my love and fidelity.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
And of the Son.
And the Son.
And of the Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit. Very good.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
You want to repeat after me?
I think I got it.
Okay.
Michael Douglas, receive this ring as a sign of my love and fidelity. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Now I want you to hold hands together and bring them toward me, and I'm going to spray them one more time.
Okay.
Dear brothers and sisters, let us accompany this new family with our prayers that the mutual love of this couple may grow daily and that God in his kindness will sustain all families throughout the world. Repeat after me, let us pray to the Lord. For Doug and Mckenzie, for their well-being and fruitful lives as one, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. For their parents and grandparents, for all family and friends who have assisted them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all married couples and families, that they may experience and reveal to others the beauty of God's love, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For those preparing for married life, and for all whom the Lord is calling to another state in life, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For the members of Doug's and Mackenzie's families who have passed from this world, and for all of those of our own, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Lord Jesus, who are present in our midst, as Doug and Mckenzie sealed their union, accept our prayers and fill us with your Spirit who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, let us join our voices as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Now let us humbly invoke God's blessing upon this bride and groom, that in his kindness he may favor with his help those on whom he has bestowed the sacrament of matrimony. O God, who by your mighty power created all things out of nothing, and when you had set in place the beginnings of the universe, form man and woman in your own image, making the woman an inseparable helpmate to the man, that they might no longer be two but one flesh, and taught that what you were pleased to make one must never divide. O God, who consecrated the bond of marriage by so great a mystery that in the wedding covenant you foreshadowed the sacrament of Christ in his church. O God, by whom woman is joined to man and the companionship that had in the beginning is now endowed with one blessing, not forfeited by original sin, nor washed away by flood. Look now with favor on these your servants, joined together in marriage, who ask to be strengthened by your blessing. Send down upon them the grace of the Holy Spirit and pour your love into their hearts, that they may remain faithful in the marriage covenant. May the grace of love and peace abide in your daughter Mckenzie, and let her always be an example of those holy women whose praises are sung in the scriptures. May her husband, Michael Douglas, entrust his heart to her, so that acknowledging her as his equal and his joint heir in the life of grace, he may show her due honor and cherish her always with the love that Christ has for his church. And now, Lord, we beg of you, may these your servants hold fast to the faith and keep your commandments made in one flesh, that they may be blameless in all that they do. And with the strength that comes from the gospel, may they bear true witness to Christ before all. May they be blessed with children and prove themselves virtuous parents who live to see their children's children. And grant that reaching at last together the fullness of their years for which they hope, they may come to the life of the blessed in the kingdom of heaven through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Bless you with this water. And I'm going to bless everyone else. I'm going to ask you to rise and turn and face them. I'll introduce you and then you can kiss. Okay? Put your hands so I don't kill you.
And may Almighty God bless all of you who are gathered here. The Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. You can rise. Turn and face now. So you can get your... Oh, man. A lot of people.
My brothers and sisters, be pleased to receive Mr. Michael Douglas and Mrs. Mckenzie Marsh.
Yes, it did, please.
Okay. There you go.